Hello everyone and welcome back. This is Paul from TechLink, and as you probably know by now, Apple has recently released a new version of software, and that is the iOS 14. Now this is one of their major updates and it comes with a lot of new features, but I will only go through the ones which I retain more important. Please know that this is available for all the devices that support iOS 13, from the iPhone 6s all the way to the 11 Pro Max and the latest SE model. But before we get into that, I would kindly ask you to subscribe to the channel so you will be notified whenever I post new videos which might turn useful for you. The first and the most obvious update is the new home screen that allows you to add widgets on it. So if you swipe from left to right, you will see that Today Center has a whole new look with completely redesigned widgets that offer more data for better functionality. If you long press the screen, you will see this plus button that allows you to add other widgets. So let's say I want to add the maps widget. When you do that, you get another option to choose in between different sizes that obviously offer different previews or functionality, so you can choose the one that works best for you. And every widget can be dragged from the today view onto the home screen, where it can be positioned alongside other app icons. Another interesting option is the widget stacks, which allow you to stack up to 10 widgets on top of one another, so you get a better space usage. To do that, you can just long press the screen and drag a widget on top of another widget and you will create a new stack. And you can do that both on home screen and today's view. Also, once you do that, you can swap between them by swiping up and down. Another thing worth mentioning is the smart stack. Long press the screen, tap the plus button, and you will see it at the top of the list. This is basically the same as a widget stack, with the difference that your iPhone will swipe in between them and bring to the top the most relevant one for you to look at based on the time of the day or your location. And it doesn't end here. You can hide some of your home screen pages from view if you would like to have a clean interface. So if you long press the screen and select the dots at the bottom that represent the home screen pages you have set up, you will see the option to uncheck different pages you don't want to see. Also, you now have the option to hide individual apps, which means that if you press the minus button, you can remove their icon from the home screen and send it to the app library, which I will take you to now. If you swipe on your last page from right to left, you will access the app library, which is a new feature that shows you all the apps you have installed divided into different categories like utilities, creativity, and so on. What I don't like about this is that some apps might be mismatched with the category, and at the moment you don't have the option to move them over to a new one. A thing worth mentioning is the fact that each folder shows the three apps in the category that you use most often. And on the fourth spot, there are some mini icons from some of the remaining apps. And if you tap there, you will see the whole list of apps in that category. Also, if you swipe down in here, you will see another list with all your installed apps organized by letters. And all this kind of reminds me of one of my favorite smartphones that I used to possess. Now, I know that for some of you, all this might seem brand new and maybe innovative, but most of the features I talked about, like the home screen with live widgets on different sizes and the app library, were all brought to the public years ago on the Windows mobile smartphones. But I'm happy they offer these options, since I used to be a huge fan of those smartphones. Moving on, incoming calls no longer take up the whole screen, but they show up as a small banner at the top of your display, so you can swipe up to dismiss it, swipe down to see other options, or you can tap these two buttons to accept or reject the call. Another great feature is the picture-in-picture, where you can watch videos or use FaceTime while doing something else. This is fairly limited at the moment since third-party app developers still need to implement this feature. However, you can use this on Safari. So when you play a video, you will see this picture-in-picture button, which if you tap, will detach the video from the main page so you can go elsewhere. And you can also pinch the window to expand it or make it smaller, move it all over the screen, or you can drag it off the screen so the video won't be visible but you will continue to hear the audio. Siri was redesigned so when activated, the interface won't take over the entire display. Instead, you will see a small animated logo at the bottom of the screen. Also, Apple claims that Siri can now answer a larger number of questions than before. So some requests that might have previously directed you to the web will now receive direct answers. Besides this, you can send audio messages through this feature, and the number of languages that Siri understands for translation purposes was now increased. Third-party browsers and mail apps can now be set as default instead of using Safari and Mail. So some might use easily their favorite apps. So let's say you would like to set Chrome as your default browser. You can do that by going to Settings, scroll down, and select Chrome. Tap Default Browser App and select the one you want, so Chrome in this case. After that, any app that tries to open a web page will launch Chrome instead of Safari. Moving on, you might have seen there is a new Translate app. This supports Arabic, Chinese, English, French, German, Italian, Japanese, Korean, Portuguese, Russian, and Spanish. And as you can see at the top, you can select the languages to translate between. And it supports both voice and text entry. Also, the translated content can be played out loud, so you can hear how it's pronounced. Another cool feature is the conversation mode. If you turn your iPhone in landscape mode, the app listens for the two languages and translates whichever is spoken. So let's say, hi, my name is Paul.
Ciao, mi chiamo Paul.
Or the other way, ciao, come stai? See, it translates to hello, how are you? This allows you to have a conversation with someone in a different language using your iPhone as a translation tool. The languages can also be downloaded, so you can use the app without an internet connection. Speaking about languages, there is another feature which I believe is limited to USA and Canada. Don't know why, but hey, if you live in there, lucky you. When you open Safari and access a foreign language website, you should have the option to translate it if you press this icon here. However, this feature is not only region locked, but also limited to only 7 languages. Another important update is regarding privacy, with some big improvements by making it clear what info apps collect, requiring more user permission and providing ways to use location features without providing specific location data. Apple claims we are going to see soon on each product page for apps on the App Store a label regarding the app and their privacy practices. So for example, if we open the App Store and an app, we are going to see here somewhere a privacy label telling you what's going on with that app, like what type of data they are collecting or how they can track you. Also, for apps that need your location to function, you can now choose to share an approximate location rather than your precise location. So if you go to settings, scroll down to privacy and select location services, and select, let's say, AccuWeather, you can have it share your precise location or a general location. That allows you to get the info you need, but it keeps the app from knowing exactly where you are. And there's a similar feature for your photo. So if you go back to privacy and select photos, you will see all the apps that require access to your photo library. So you can choose to block them, let's say Gmail, and you can allow them access to all of the photos, none of them, or just specific photos. Still under the privacy matter, if an app is using either the microphone or the camera for recording purposes, a small light is visible at the top of the display. This is activated whether the app is in active use or is being used in the background. So you can make sure that apps are not secretly recording without your knowledge. So for example, when you are using your camera, you will see a small green light at the top of the screen. And when an app, let's say a voice recorder, is using your microphone, you will see an orange light. Last but not least, I would like to take you through some new features regarding the camera. You now have an option called Quick Take for shooting quick videos straight from the photo tab by long pressing the shutter. And if you drag it to your right, you can release it without stopping the video from recording. Also, in the video tab, you can now change the resolution and frame rate straight from the camera app. And if you go to your camera settings, you will see a few different options like prioritize faster shooting, which adapts the image quality when the shutter is rapidly pressed. And you also get a selfie mirroring option, which allows you to capture the image seen in the front camera preview, unlike the standard selfie where the picture flips. As I mentioned at the beginning of the video, iOS 14 comes with loads of small new features that would be impossible for me to cover in a single video, and I'm sure we will get new updates pretty soon. So if you would like to see more videos on the iOS 14, please subscribe to the channel. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a thumbs up. And like always, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.